We hope that you enjoy today's material. There is certainly wide appeal in today's content, and I trust that you will gain a great deal from the material presented. Now I'd like to introduce you to today's presenter, Pat Stephenson. Pat is from ANC in Vancouver and is a principal geologist and director of ANC Consultants. Ladies and gentlemen, Pat Stephenson. Thanks.
Thank you, Will. Yes, I am Pat Stephenson. Before we get started, I'll just explain that the webinar is set for a two-hour period, although we are permitted to run a bit over time if necessary. We will get through the presentation material first and then address questions. So please feel free to use your dashboard throughout the seminar. If we don't get to your question directly today, we will get back to you after the session. Your questions are tagged with your email, and so we can respond to you directly. Okay, we will make a start. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is what you should be seeing at the moment. And there's, as you can see, under questions is the box where you can type in questions to send to us. I'd like to welcome everybody to this seminar and thank you for joining us here. We have over 100 attendees from all around the world. There's been very wide interest in this seminar, which I think demonstrates the importance and the relevance of this topic at any time in our industry, whether the times are good or not good. There's the issue of mineral resources and mineral reserves are always critically important. So we're running this seminar because we believe in the importance of this topic, and also because AMC has seen an increase in recent times of relatively poor practice in this area. And it's been caused in part by the cutbacks that are occurring in the industry these days, with the resultant loss of experienced personnel and having to put the workload on people who don't have quite the experience that may be necessary for this field. I have a particular interest in this topic because I've spent most of my 44 years in the industry in the area of mineral resources and mineral reserves, both in estimation, classification, and reporting. I've written and presented extensively on the subject, and I'd like to share some of my knowledge and experience with you today. And this PowerPoint presentation will be emailed to you in a few days after the presentation. The outline of what we will be talking about is shown there. What is a mineral resource and a mineral reserve? What is not a mineral resource and a mineral reserve? The importance of good estimation, classification, and reporting of mineral resources and reserves. Qualified persons and competent persons, which is a critical part of this whole reporting system. Reasonable prospects judgment in respect of mineral resources is very important. We'll spend a few minutes on that. Touch on international and national reporting standards, primarily for people who are preparing National Instrument 43-101 technical reports. There are a few slides on the traps to avoid when you're preparing these types of reports. And a presentation like this can't be done without a reference to probably the most famous shall we say, inappropriate resource estimate made, and that was BUSE. Now, when I first mentioned the title of this talk to some of my colleagues, a few of them didn't know what was meant by pie in the sky. So I thought I'd better explain that from the beginning, and it is something that is pleasant to contemplate, but is very unlikely to be realized. And unfortunately, in our industry, present time, some of the mineral resource estimates that are in the public domain fall into that description. Just a little bit about myself. I have been in the industry since 1971, primarily working in resources and reserves. I have been with AMC Consultants since 2001. I came to Canada from Australia in 2007, I'm currently a director and principal geologist of AMC Consultants. I was a member of the JORC Committee in Australia for 18 years, and for 7 years I was secretary, and for 6 years I was chairman. And it's also relevant to note that a colleague of mine, Peter Stoker, who's one of our principal geologists in Brisbane, has also been involved in JORC for a similar amount of time and took over from me as secretary and as chair. I was co-chair of the Committee for Mineral Reserves International Reporting Standards in 2005 and 2006. Peter Stoker remains a member of that committee. And more recently, I've become a member of the Canadian CIMVAL Committee on Valuation and also the Australian Valmin Committee on Valuation. AMC Consultants is a large consulting group that specializes purely in mining engineering, geology, and related areas such as geotechnical, backfill, ventilation, and those sorts of areas. I've listed there the services that we offer and the clients that that we service. We service clients ranging from a junior exploration company to the largest, such as BHP and Rio Tinto. And in Canada, where this webinar is being run from, we have about a third of our consultants, 20 mining engineers, 6 geologists, 5 geotechnical engineers, and 1 civil engineer. So, what is a mineral resource? Now, I'm not giving you the dictionary definition here. These are my descriptions of what is a mineral resource. And it's an estimate of tonnage and grade for a mineralized body that's based on sampling of that body. One of the examples I was going to include in this seminar, this webinar, concerned an estimate of inferred resources made once on a deposit that I was consulting on that was essentially based on very little sampling of that body, and it caused quite a bit of problems both for myself and for the company that was reporting it. So a resource estimate represents a realistic inventory that, under assumed and justifiable technical and economic conditions, might in whole or in part become economically extractable. And the whole or part economically extractable is a reference to the mineral reserves. Resources are subdivided into inferred, indicated, and measured. Now, I've put some plus or minus accuracy or confidence limits against those categories. This isn't generally done. You won't normally see these limits assigned to these categories. So they are my personal belief as to what ranges apply to these categories. And I do make the note that it does depend on the scale of the volume that you're classifying, and I'll reference that later on. A mineral reserve is the economically mineable part of a measured or indicated mineral resource. And these days, pretty much all the normal or commonly used reporting standards require that in order to convert those mineral resources to mineral reserves, you must have carried out a study that's equivalent to or a higher level than a pre-feasibility study. To convert the resources to the reserves, you must apply realistically assumed modifying factors, as I'll show in the next diagram. And probably the simplest definition of a mineral reserve is that it's an estimate of the tonnage and the grade that is expected to be delivered to the mill or treatment plant. That's a pretty much a good summary of what it is, because that encapsulates then the concept that mineral reserves must include any diluting materials that are taken as part of extracting the resource, and must allow for any mining losses that occur when you do that extraction. And they are subdivided into probable and proven. And this diagram, which comes from the Crisco template, which I'll refer to later, shows the relationship between mineral resources and mineral reserves. So we have exploration information, which is at the earliest stages of exploration before you have done sufficient drilling or sampling to enable a mineral resource to be estimated. Once you've done sufficient sampling, you are able to estimate a mineral resource, and it's subdivided into the three categories that I mentioned with increasing geological knowledge and confidence. Mineral reserves are converted from mineral resources by the consideration of mining, processing, metallurgical, infrastructure, economic, marketing, legal, environmental, social, and government factors that are called the modifying factors. And it is possible to convert measured resources to probable reserves rather than proven reserves or proved reserves if the application of some of these modifying factors means that you have less confidence in the resulting mineral reserve than you had in the mineral resource from which it derives, in which case you may well classify the resulting mineral reserve as probable. A couple of important points to remember is that mineral resource and mineral reserve estimates, they are really estimates. They're not calculations in that they're not only derived from calculating numbers. There are a lot of issues that go into mineral resource and mineral reserve estimates, as we'll cover later on in this webinar. And the combination of all those factors means that you are really estimating the tons and grade, although calculations are part of that estimation process. Another important point is that there is no single correct mineral resource or mineral reserve estimate for a given deposit. And this diagram is one that I use to illustrate for a mineral reserve that there is no single correct mineral reserve estimate. It shows on the horizontal axis cutoff grade. In this case, it's grams per ton gold, from 3 grams per ton up to 12 grams per ton. On the right-hand side is the ounces of gold in reserves. And as you would expect, as you increase the cutoff grade, you decrease the amount of ounces in the reserves. On the left-hand side is a measure of value, in this case, net present value in millions of dollars, but it might be another measure. And this is a hypothetical example, but it shows that the value starts off at, let's say, 10 million at this point, increases as you increase the cutoff grade for reasons to do with the economics of mining larger tonnages at lower grade and smaller tonnages at a higher grade and the consequent efficiencies that can be gained. And then it may decrease as you continue to increase the cutoff grade. The point to make on this diagram is that anywhere on this horizontal axis between 3 and 12 grams per ton could be a legitimate mineral reserve. It depends on the company's appetite for risk and its priorities in terms of life of mine versus value, if you like. A junior company, for example, might want to maximize payback time by extracting the highest grades possible at the beginning, whereas a major company may be more interested in a long mine life. So two companies that own the same deposit could have different perceptions of what the reserves are. What is not a mineral resource? Well, the prime description of that is that portions of a deposit that do not have reasonable prospects for eventual economic extraction cannot be classified as a mineral resource. And some examples include, but aren't limited to, some the ones I've listed there. A very common one that we see in the industry these days is a resource estimate being quoted at a single cutoff grade that is appropriate to open pit mining, but it includes material that is well below the limit of any reasonable expectation of open pit mining. And that is misleading because those deeper resources would have to be extracted by underground mining, therefore they should be quoted at a higher cutoff grade. Isolated blocks that are remote from existing infrastructure, underground infrastructure or mining infrastructure, or any that is reasonably likely to be developed, should be removed from mineral resources. And also, if they're based on single drill holes that, again, remote from other drill holes, such that you can't reasonably establish continuity, should generally be removed from resources. There may be situations where it's permissible to include them, but they would tend to be the exception. If you make estimates in physical locations, that renders mining very unlikely, or in fact impossible, in the longer term, then they should not be classified as a mineral resource, because a mineral resource, you're reporting to the public, and you're telling the public that what you're reporting to them has reasonable prospects for eventual economic extraction. If the reality is it doesn't have those reasonable prospects, it should not be publicly reported. Estimates are sometimes made on the basis of unreasonable longer-term projection of metal prices. Now, this is a time-dependent variable. These days, with the gold price under $1,100, for example, it would be unreasonable, probably, to report a mineral resource at a $2,000 gold price. But 2 or 3 years ago, when the gold price was getting close to $1,800, that may not have been unreasonable. So that judgment always has to be made in the context of the present day and reasonable projections into the future. Any pillars that have been rendered permanently unmineable in an underground mine must be excluded from a mineral resource. You can maintain an inventory of these sorts of bodies in your internal company records, but they shouldn't be reported to the public. as being potentially extractable. And what is not a mineral reserve, firstly, any portions of a measured or indicated mineral resource that have not been shown to be economically mineable on the basis of a study that's at least a pre-feasibility study cannot be classified as a mineral reserve. And likewise, if they haven't yet been subjected to that sort of study, then they can't be called a mineral reserve. I should also say that mineral reserve and ore reserve are mean exactly the same thing. Because I'm currently in Canada, where I'm running this from, the term that we use here is mineral reserve, but ore reserve is used in other parts of the world. If any of the modifying factors that are used in converting mineral resources to mineral reserves, if there are unreasonable assumptions made, for example, if you assume that you are going to recover 100% metallurgical recovery, 100% of your copper project, copper deposit, in all likelihood, that's an unreasonable assumption. So you need to be careful that the modifying factors can be well justified on and substantiated. So some examples would include estimates that have been subject to a scoping study, or what in Canada is called a preliminary economic assessment, or a PEA. Because that's a lower level study than a pre-feasibility study, you're not able to convert resources to reserves. And estimates in physical locations that have some potential to be mined in the longer term, but not in the short to medium term, can remain in mineral resources, but should be removed from mineral reserves. And the same with pillars and other remnant bodies. Inferred mineral resources cannot be converted directly to a mineral reserve. They must first be upgraded to an indicated mineral resource or a measured mineral resource. And deposits for which, for example, metallurgical treatment characteristics or other modifying factors mean that the mineral resources are uneconomic in the short to medium term, again, they can't be called a mineral reserve. So getting on to the importance of mineral resources and mineral reserves, and I know that most of you attending this webinar will be familiar with this subject and familiar with the importance, but I think it's worth restating, because they are, first and foremost, they're fundamental to the viability of all mining projects. If they are badly flawed, there's a high probability that the project will fail, or it'll be seriously compromised, which usually means requiring a lot more money to resolve whatever the situation is. And in some unfortunate situations, it can lead to litigation and a lot of money being spent on that litigation, or in the settlement that may come as a result of it. And to illustrate, particularly to geologists who perhaps aren't so familiar with who actually depends on these resource and reserve estimates, I've listed here the sorts of groups that pay close regard to these estimates. The board of directors of the company, because these are the fundamental asset of the company, and the board takes responsibility for the public statements made on their assets. Mine management, mining professionals, accountants, banks. I won't go through that list, because the next slide I show for what purpose these various groups rely on resource and reserve estimates. Now, then, probably there are purposes beyond those I've listed, but I believe that these do illustrate the the sorts of uses that resource and reserve estimates are put to. So company boards need to approve major financial and development decisions, and they'll have regard to the resource and reserve estimates. If they are making a company valuation, that will be fundamentally impacted by those estimates. Raising funds is another obvious one. Mine management are the ones that are tasked with making the financial and development decisions on the mine and approving operational budgets. And they are driven quite substantially by resource and reserve estimates. Company professionals, and I mean by this that, say, the mining engineers that use the mineral resource estimates and the metallurgists and other professionals that use the mineral reserve estimates, these are the basis for the short to long term mine plans, which underpin the life of mine plan for any mine. They're used for the detailed ore extraction planning and for the design of the processing plant and for many other aspects of the operation. An area that many geologists, I suspect, may not be aware of is that accountants do depend on resource and reserve estimates for depreciation and amortization schedules and asset impairment decisions and rehabilitation provisions. And it's important also for groups like accountants to take the time to understand how resource and reserve estimates are prepared and the confidence that there is in those estimates, because sometimes they assume there's a degree of accuracy and precision in the estimates that is may not be warranted. Banks, they will make their lending decisions in a large part on the resource and reserve estimates. Investors on whether to invest or whether to hold their investments. Analysts and brokers on the basis of, they make it the basis for advice. Regulatory and statutory bodies, these days in many mining countries, it's part of the conditions of listing on a stock exchange that the company complies with the reporting standards that have been developed by the industry. That's the resource and reserve reporting standards. So compliance with those standards is both a legal requirement in some countries and a regulatory requirement. And government and government organizations will also have regard to these estimates. So you can see there's a very wide range of people and groups that take these estimates very seriously. Here's a case study that I was involved in the later 1970s. It involved the Kalian gold mine in Indonesia. It was a dispute between CRA, which was at that time part of the Rio Tinto group, and its ex-minority partner in the Kalian operation, Kalimantan Gold. CRA bought out its minority partner, Kalimantan Gold, before the mine began production. But after it had begun production, it was producing significantly more gold than had been predicted from the ore reserve estimates. So the litigation was, Kalimantan entered into litigation against CRA because they felt that either they had been misled or that in fact there had been some degree of inappropriate or fraudulent practice. There was a confidential settlement in mid-1997, but one of the important points, I think, for the purposes of how much these sorts of issues can cost is that Now, this is my estimate. This is not an official estimate. But that both sides had spent at least $25 million on the litigation before it had actually got to court. So you can see it was an extremely expensive process. And apart from the money, it involved the management of the companies involved spending a significant amount of their time on the case, and that time is very valuable. And in the end, the confidential settlement was made, it was confidential, and so we don't know exactly what was concluded in terms of what caused the problem, but I can tell you that it involved experts on every aspect of resource estimation, classification, and reporting from all around the world. This is a second case study that I had some involvement in. It was in Africa. And before the mine began, the consulting company one estimated mineral resources for oxide mineralization, which was part of a larger deposit. That was subsequently shown when the mine entered into production, they were shown to be 25% or in that order greater than the mine actually realized. And as is not uncommon these days, a class action lawsuit was filed. And some months later, a second consulting company was estimating mineral resources for the same oxide mineralization, and it estimated resources that were about 50% less than the mine production. The important point here is that consulting company two had the benefit of knowing how the mine had been reconciling against what had been previously predicted on the basis of grade control results and mine production. But even with the benefit of that knowledge, it was not possible to estimate the mineral resources or not possible to 100% reconcile the resources with what was being produced. In any event, the class action lawsuit settled out of court, but this is another instance where you have to be very careful with these sorts of deposits, particularly ones that are a bit nuggety. Because even with good information on mine production, it can be very difficult to estimate truly what the mine will produce. Excuse me, I'm just going to take a sip of water. By the way, as I said at the beginning, if you do have any questions, certainly feel free to type them in and send them to us. As I said, we may get to them during the course of this presentation if we have time. If not, I will certainly respond to individual questions after the webinar. Okay, mineral resource estimation. Now, the requirements for good mineral resource estimation really can be summarized into three main ones. There's obviously a lot more going to them, just these three points, but these are probably the most critical ones. And the first one is you must have confident geological interpretation. Now, the degree of confidence will vary, of course, depending on the information you have and the classification of the mineral resource, but you must be able to interpret the geological controls to some degree. Secondly, you must have samples and assays of mineralization that are both high quality and are representative of the mineralization. And the high quality is usually ensured through using best practice in the collection of the samples and in the sampling process and assaying process, and also in what we call QA/QC, quality assurance, quality control, practices that are implemented in the course of the preparation of samples or assays. Then the third one is the application of an appropriate estimation technique. I will say, though, that usually if the first two points are followed well, the third point often has a lesser impact on the overall estimate than these first two points. And the geological interpretation comes from mapping and sampling the deposit, logging the drill core and mapping underground workings and surface workings, surface exposures, and putting it all together in three dimensions. It is most important in mineral resource estimation that particularly the geology is understood at, if you like, a hands-on level. There is a tendency these days for everything to be computerized and put into a digital model, then just interpreted in 3D space and spun around and played with in 3D space, and forgetting that what really counts here is to understand in detail what the geology looks like. And so it's very important that you don't just sit in front of your computer and play with things on the model. You must go out, look at the drill core, look at the underground workings, ensure that everything is tied together sensibly, and that you have a good handle on that aspect. As I said, the high quality and representative samples come from ensuring the highest standards of sampling and assaying integrity, but also the running of high quality QA/QC programs. My apologies. And the appropriate estimation technique is really dependent on employing an experienced and a qualified person, as we refer to here, the qualified or the competent person, and allowing them to exercise their judgment as to the most appropriate technique. This is a case study I was involved in about 20 years ago in Australia. It's a cross-section through a polymetallic base metal deposit. That's an underground working there, and these lines were underground drill holes that were drilled into what was essentially a synclinal type of deposit. That's the hanging wall, that's the foot wall. The ore horizon, as it's termed here between these two blue lines, is the horizon that contains the higher grades of lead and zinc. The areas in dashed red lines are the areas that visually, on a sulfide basis, you would tend to join together. So that visually, if you could see this in underground in its entirety, you would see massive sulfide body somewhat with that shape, with these shapes. When I was auditing this estimate, it was apparent that the resources had been domained, as we say, on the basis of strict zinc equivalent cutoff. In other words, zinc plus lead plus silver and copper taken back to the equivalent cutoff in zinc terms. And that had been interpreted in the drill holes and then joined together, as you can see here. The net result was these bodies These comprise the mineral resources. Now, that would appear to be quite sensible, but it's very important that mineral resources are not only properly, if you like, ideally estimated, to use a word, but they also take into account the practicality of the extraction. And having worked in a similar sort of mine where there was massive sulfides with, in this case, tin distributed throughout the massive sulfides, but completely invisible in the massive sulfides, I knew that when it comes to mining, almost certainly what would be mined is the massive sulfides, because this outline is not visible. It would be entirely assay-based. In theory, that could be done, but it would be very expensive, and it would also potentially involve leaving in the stope massive sulfide, and that can be dangerous from a mining point of view because there is a risk of self-combustion. So I reinterpreted the mineral resources to essentially be the massive sulfide that enclosed the not random distribution of zinc and lead and silver grades, but a distribution that was difficult to isolate. This is a, believe it or not, is actually a real life example. It's not one that I have personal knowledge of, so it comes from a reference back in 1978, HOPPE, the Stekenjokk mine in Sweden. Individual drill holes, 20 meters apart. The red intersections were the mineralization as intersected in the drill holes, and they were joined together, as you can see here, which would appear to make a lot of sense to join them together that way. However, apparently, when they either opened up this deposit for mining or perhaps when they did more drilling, I'm not sure which, it turned out that the shape of this body was like this. I mean, it was quite almost unbelievable that that's what it would look like on the basis of those intersections, but apparently that was the case. Now, you would think that if these were diamond drill holes, there might have been some information available that would have suggested that an interpretation almost at right angles to the drill core might be problematic because perhaps there were some angles in the drill core that suggested that the trend was more like 30 degrees. But if they were percussion drill holes or some other form of drilling, non-core drilling, then perhaps that information wasn't available. Anyway, that's an extreme example of the caution you must exercise in a geological interpretation. This is a real-life example from a colleague of mine in an open pit that shows how complex geology can be. And in this case, the decision was made to domain all of this complex area into one domain. There was obviously no possibility of trying to individually domain out these folds. And perhaps, I don't know where this mine is, but perhaps from a mineralization point of view, it wasn't necessary anyway because perhaps these were the overall mineralization controls. This is an illustration that I like to use more for non-technical users of mineral resource estimates to try and get across the challenge of mineral resource estimation. And I'd like you to imagine several knitting needles or just sticks penetrating the room that you're sitting in. Now, if you're sitting in a large boardroom, it may be, perhaps you could imagine, 4 to 5 knitting needles penetrating that room from floor to ceiling. If you're in a smaller an office, it may be only one or two. But in the course of those knitting needles, they will intersect various things. And in this case, they've intersected a bit of a filing cabinet, a bit of a, in this case, a person, which is a bit unfortunate, but hopefully he's okay. Intersected a chair there, and obviously the ceiling, and perhaps a light fitting. And that's all the information that's there. Mineral resource estimation, sorry, I'll step back on. And then what you have to do with that limited information of what these knitting needles have intersected is to try and recreate the total contents of the room. Now you can see how challenging that could be, not only because, for example, you don't know how many people are in the room, even though you've intersected one of them. And as an example, this pillar wasn't intersected, and yet it may be, in the context of mineralization, that may be where the valuable components of the mineralization are concentrated. It's a possibility. So mineral resource estimation is very similar to that. You have a very little amount, small amount of information, and you have to try and recreate what the deposit looks like from that information. It's not quite as challenging as I've outlined here, because we do have some idea normally of what the room should look like on the basis of our understanding of the geological model. And so it's not quite as bad, but nevertheless, you can see why we always refer to mineral resources as estimates, not calculations. Another point to bear in mind is that for each drill sample that is analyzed, it might be a meter or it might be half a meter, and it's usually a split drill core, but that needs to be reduced down to essentially usually a teaspoonful of material. It depends on the assaying method, whether it's a teaspoonful or more or less than that. And it wouldn't usually, this is sugar in this case, just to illustrate the point, but it would of course be pulverized at this point. But this is the amount that gets analyzed. So you can see how critically important it is that the way in which the half meter of split drill core is both reduced in volume and in grain size to finally produce a teaspoonful of essentially talcum powder is so important. I'll go through fairly quickly some common mineral resource estimation methods. And what I propose to do is perhaps in around 10 minutes' time to take a break for about 5 minutes to give everybody a chance to go and get a drink or something, and then we'll commence again. The most common, excuse me for a moment. The common resource estimation methods these days are, and this is probably in order of how common they are, block modeling with kriging, block modeling with inverse distance weighting, the sectional or longitudinal methods, and the polygonal method. And I think most people would be familiar with block modeling, but for those non-technical people in the audience today, I'll just explain briefly that the process is, firstly, the geological interpretation is applied, and one of the outcomes of that is to what we say domain or constrain, outline, if you like, the boundaries of the mineralized zones. In this case, this is what the boundary looks like. And there may be another one out here, and there may be another one here, and perhaps at lower depths, and so on. The next step in resource estimation is to fill that volume that's been outlined, because this has a depth to it as well. Fill it with blocks, equal-sized blocks. Now, there's nothing magic about doing this. This is purely done to aid the estimation process. So it's filled with equal-sized blocks, both in plan view and at depth, except around the boundaries, depending on the estimation software. Sub-blocks would be used, smaller blocks, or perhaps proportional blocks would be used. And now the real challenge comes in estimating the grade of each of these blocks, because essentially all we do is estimate the grade in each of these blocks and then add all the blocks together. So in concept, you can see it's a very simple process. In detail, it can be quite complicated. And the complicated part comes in the estimation of the block grade from the samples that surround the block, because there will be drill holes, which I haven't shown, which are going through this mineralized zone, and they will have samples, and they've been assayed, and we use those assays in order to allocate the grade to each of these blocks. And the two main ways that that is done is either what we call kriging or inverse distance weighting. Kriging is part of a process called geostatistics, and I won't go into that in any detail because it's a complex subject on its own. But again, in concept, it's simple. Geostatistics looks at the trends in mineralization within the deposit. So, for example, depending on the way a deposit has formed, there will usually be a trend in the mineralization. In other words, for example, there may be greater continuity of grades in this direction than in that direction, in a north-south direction on this diagram than an east-west direction. And that would come from the way in which the mineralization was deposited. If that's the case, then it obviously makes logical sense that samples that are in this direction, let's say that at equal distance to the block of samples in this direction from the block, that these samples have more influence on the block than ones in this direction, if they're equal distance. And the analysis of those trends and reducing that analysis to equations that can be used is called the application of geostatistics, variography, the creation of semivariograms, and the creation of kriging equations. But at this high level that we're talking about, all we need to concern ourselves with is that it enables us to use a weighting to apply to the samples in proximity to the block to aid in the grade estimation in the block. And inverse distance weighting, that only takes into account how far the sample is from the block, and depending on that distance, it will get the relative weight applied to for the purposes of grade estimation. And the most common application is inverse distance squared, but also these days inverse distance cubed is used, and I've even seen inverse distance to the power of 5, which is not common and is usually only used for limited purposes. The sectional method is fairly straightforward. Body is divided up into cross, is cut through with cross sections, usually the sections on which the drilling has been done. The interpretation is carried out on the cross sections and tied together in three-dimensional space. And then the intersections are given the grade of that intersection halfway to the next intersection, and so on throughout the deposit, and also between section lines, and again, the whole thing is then aggregated together after applying bulk density to convert the volume to tonnes to arrive at the tonnes and grade. I am skipping through this fairly quickly because we do have a mix of people on the webinar today, many of whom are non-technical. You also see polygonal methods used. They're not so common these days in countries like Canada and Australia and the USA, much of Europe and South America, but they are still used in many countries, and they're often used as an early stage estimation method or a check on another estimation method. And it's a much simpler method in that this might be a plan view. That's a drill hole in the middle that's going down vertically. And the thickness and grade of that intersection is applied to the polygon that surrounds the hole halfway to the next intersection. And similar to sectional methods, they are then all aggregated together to arrive at the overall tons of grade. The point to make with resource estimation methods is that none of these methods I've mentioned are wrong. All of them may be applicable in the right situation. And I have seen some commentary that implies that, for example, polygonal estimation is wrong. I wouldn't agree with that. I think it has its place to play, but you need to appreciate the limitations that go with all these methods, and polygonal methods in particular do have a tendency to overestimate grade. That can be countered to some degree in the method, but it's somewhat inherent in the method, so that needs to be borne in mind. In theory, kriging, because of its because of the way that it applies weighting to the various samples around the block, should give the best estimate of block grade. Now, that all depends, of course, on the variogram having been interpreted properly and aspects that I won't go into in detail, like the nugget effect and so on. When you're running a resource estimate, it's standard practice and it's good practice to always check it with another estimation method. Mineral reserve estimation, and I apologize for not having many slides on this subject, but mineral reserve estimation largely flows from mineral resource estimation anyway, and it's derived through the application, as I previously said, of realistically assumed modifying factors. In reality, the main action that's carried out is the design of the mine, an open pit mine or an underground mine. Not necessarily in detail, but at least there has to be some form of mine design applied at a study level that's at least a pre-feasibility study in order to convert the resources to the reserves. And I'll come to Industry Guide 7 and the reason for its use of a feasibility study a bit later. But most reporting standards require, as I said before, a pre-feasibility study to have been carried out. This is a case study we were recently involved in AMC. It's an open pit situation, and as you can see, this is the outline of the deposit as defined on the drilling that's been carried out. When that was converted to mineral resources by applying an appropriate cutoff grade and taking into account probable mining and treatment characteristics, we derived the areas in red. So as you can see, the mineral resources are substantially less than everything that had been drilled. When this was then looked at for conversion to mineral reserves, it could be seen that at present, on the parameters that were applied, everything that was potentially mineable by underground means would not be economic in the near term. Therefore, it couldn't be converted to reserves. And so what was left was only what could be extracted in the open pit. And so only the open pit material could be reported at this point in time as mineral reserves. So you can see that there can be a vast difference between the deposit as outlined by drilling and what eventually becomes a mineral reserve. Now, of course, the material that didn't convert to a mineral reserve at this stage still has potential to be extracted in the future by underground means, so it remains in mineral resources. And the main factors affecting resource and reserve estimation are, I think I've really mentioned these before, but to reiterate them because they are very important, is the reliability of the geological interpretation, the amount, the distribution, and the quality of resource data. For some deposits, how you treat the very high grades. And to some degree, that was what was happening with the two case studies that I mentioned, Kalian and the one in Africa. There was an element there of what we call nuggety gold. The assumptions regarding mining and treatment methods. And as you can see from the previous case study, because underground mining of that project would not be viable in the short term, it couldn't be converted to reserves. Very importantly, assumptions regarding commodity prices and exchange rates, and the experience and the judgment of the qualified or the competent person. That's another critical aspect. Just to illustrate a couple of high nugget situations. This is from the Bendigo field in Australia, which was mined in the late 1800s through to about the mid-1900s, a very prolific gold field and a very important one in the development of Australia as a nation. But it's characterized by very nuggety gold, and this is just some of the flakes and nuggets of gold that came out of a sampling program at Bendigo. You can see the range from 2.3 centimeters here down to obviously much finer gold. And Bendigo is notoriously difficult in estimating resources and reserves. And this one is a very unusual situation. We're actually looking here at a face underground, a mining exposure underground. That white is massive quartz, and this is where a surface drill hole was intersected in the underground workings. And going back to the drill core for the hole, close to that point, the drill hole intersected 7.5 meters at 2.9 grams per ton gold. Had a tiny speck of visible gold, but otherwise no visible gold. However, within less than a meter of that drill hole was this massive area of gold, volume of gold, that comprised 7 tons of quartz, and it turned out to contain 3,500 ounces of gold. So that's 500 ounces of gold per ton. And that was less than a meter from a drill hole that had 2.9 grams per ton. So you can see how challenging it can be to estimate resources and reserves in that environment. I think I will leave it there for 5 minutes because my voice is needing a refreshment to keep going, and I'm sure some of you need to take a comfort break or a... Okay, I'll mute my mic, and we'll be back in 5 to 7 minutes. Okay. Thanks, everybody. We will resume now. Okay. I've got a couple of slides here that, and these are summarized from an article that one of our principal geologists, Rod Webster, had in the CIM magazine in October 2015. Because he and others in AMC were becoming concerned about what we were seeing as problems arising from a lack of experience in resource and reserve estimation, almost certainly due to companies cutting back on personnel and cutting back on expenditure. I'll go through these fairly quickly. And the most important one probably is the insufficient understanding and use of the geological interpretation with an over-reliance on software and statistics and geostatistics. And that really reinforces what I said earlier on, that you must not just become a computer-bound modeler. You must understand the geology thoroughly and have a hands-on experience with it. Inclusion of low-grade resources located deep below the surface, that's a point I made earlier. Substantial tonnages being based on single drill hole intersections. It's very important here, and one of the handouts that is available to you called the Spotted Dog paper talks about this to some degree, but it's very important that people understand what the various reporting standards say in terms of continuity of grade and geology. Because just having annulus or circles, if you like, of classification around individual drill holes is not what's intended when these standards talk about continuity between sampling points. I'll talk on that a little later. If the high-grade drill hole intersections are not dealt with properly in the resource estimation processes, they can be smeared out into barren material. I've just referred to the Spotted Dog, and I've referred to crown and sill pillars that are still being left in resource and reserves when they shouldn't be. This is one we see sometimes where some of the resource or reserves are based on very narrow veins adjacent to areas that were previously mined, without really taking sufficient account of whether they are truly extractable. There may be geotechnical issues why they're not, or if you like, if they require backfill in order to be extractable, then that needs to be taken into account. Minimum mining width on narrow veins is a very important aspect that is sometimes not properly accounted for. At the resource stage, you must consider the minimum width that can be conceivably extracted. That's not to say you're trying to mimic what would be done at the reserve stage, but obviously you can't estimate a mineral resource down to 0.1 of a meter if there is no chance that you could actually mine at those thicknesses. So you need to widen the intersection out to whatever the minimum conceivable mining thickness is, and then apply the cutoff grade. And if that intersection, once it's been widened out, meets the cutoff grade, then it can be included. But in summary, the issues that we're seeing are insufficient knowledge of the basics of good resource and reserve estimation and of industry reporting standards. Now, the first one is really a function of the experience that the qualified or competent person or the person doing the estimate has, and clearly that's only partly under their control. But the second one is entirely under their control. There is no excuse for not being familiar with the relevant reporting standard in your country. Please make sure you read it fully and not just a few extracts from it. And the other one is really related to that. We're seeing insufficient experience sometimes to enable people to make the sorts of decisions that are essential. That's not their fault. That's a function of how much experience they have in the industry. But always remember, if you're being asked to act as a qualified or a competent person, it's a very serious responsibility that you're being asked to accept. You need to understand what you're taking on, what the risks for you are, and what your responsibilities are, and don't accept that qualification as a competent person or a qualified person if you're not entirely confident that you do qualify. Okay, I will move through now classification. I may move through some of these a bit more quickly now because some of them repeat what I've previously said. You will be getting a copy of this presentation anyway, and also I'm keeping an eye on the time. It's important to realize why we classify resources and reserves. I don't think many people think about that, but it is to convey the qualified or the competent person's confidence in the estimates. Once they leave the qualified or the competent person's hands and get used by other people, those people quite often won't fully understand the level of confidence that there was in the estimate that was made. And one way that the qualified or competent person can convey a degree of that knowledge is to classify them appropriately. It's also important that the indicated and inferred boundary is given very careful consideration, because inferred resources can't be converted directly to mineral reserves. And so a lot of thought needs to go into that decision, and again, go back to the relevant reporting standards, and I'll come onto that later. They're used for guiding further exploration and infill drilling, and they're classified to help people who have less knowledge of the deposit than the qualified person. Classification doesn't have to be complicated, but it must reflect the qualified or the competent person's confidence in the estimate. The chosen criteria must be justified by good geological understanding. So it's very important not just to pluck some statistical parameters out of the air and base your classification on those without thinking how they relate to the geology of the deposit and the continuity that is shown by that geology. And these are the normal factors that are taken into account. There are others, but these are the most common: drilling sampling density, quality, geology, the robustness of the grade estimation, and the cutoff grade, and I'll mention that a bit later. I won't go through these in detail because the definitions are available in the various reporting standards, but inferred resources is the least confident of the estimates, but there is still sufficient confidence in the grade and or geological continuity that it can be, and also confidence that there are reasonable prospects for eventual economic extraction that allow it to be classified as a resource. Indicated resources are can be estimated with a reasonable level of confidence, reasonable in this context means usually that you can apply something like a pre-feasibility study to the indicated resources and thereby convert them, if appropriate, to probable reserves. And measured resources are the highest level of mineral resource estimates. It's important to remember that measured resources and proved reserves don't mean that no more drilling would need to be done. Frequently at the mine, detailed mine planning stage, stope drilling might have to be done in order to have enough information to plan the detailed stope design properly. I won't go through this in detail, but it's my suggestions as to a good step-by-step approach to mineral resource classification. The main thing I'll emphasize is that the first point often ends up being the last point, and that causes problems that we discuss in AMC's spotted dog paper. That's where the block model is subdivided according to measures of grade estimation reliability into individual blocks. And quite often, that's where the classification stops. That is not the final classification, or at least it shouldn't be. It needs to be smoothed out to make it more practical and more in line with the intent of the reporting standards. This is a mental exercise I've used throughout my career in helping to guide me when I'm deciding whether something can be measured, indicated, or inferred. I try to imagine the effect of infill drilling. And if the infill drilling, I believe, would have no material impact on the geological interpretation or the confidence in the grade distribution, or even if it could have an impact, it wouldn't result in a significantly different estimate of tons and grade. Usually at that point, I'm prepared to call it measured, but assuming that the data is of a good quality. Likewise, with indicated, the difference here is that it could have a difference, but mainly, though, in the distribution of the mineralized zones rather than the overall or the global mineral resource estimate. And the qualified or the competent person needs to have enough confidence for it to be used for mine planning. And inferred is, if you like, the corollary to those two. It is important to remember that extrapolations of projected inferred resources beyond data points must be given careful consideration, because sometimes the extrapolation is unreasonable. It's taken too far. Case study. This was one I was involved in the mid-1990s. It was a weathered deposit in West Africa, laterite and saprolite zones. There were two resource estimates, one in February 1996 and one in June. The drilling base was pretty much the same. Now, the laterite resource remained unchanged between those two estimates, but the saprolite resource in February 1996 was classified 5% measured, 95% indicated. In June, that same resource, or that same saprolite deposit with virtually no more data, was classified 95% measured, 5% indicated. Now, this is, as you can see, what can happen when you, with qualified persons, can disagree. Now, in this case, it was actually the same person. I don't think that they've gone back and really looked at the previous estimate. The only difference was the estimation technique. In February, inverse distance squared was used, and in June, polygonal was used. Now, that was quite a strange decision to revert back to polygonal, which is generally only used at an early stage, when previously the ID squared had been used. So I had to reject the revised classification And that caused quite a problem for the company because it was in the middle of a capital raising. Another case study in Eastern Europe, that where the competent person classified the mineral resource according to the number of samples that were found within the search ellipses. And I apologize to non-technical people who are a bit unsure what I'm talking about here, but I haven't time to go into the detail. But the result was that he classified the resource as 8% measured and 92% indicated. When he saw the result, he was uncomfortable. He thought there should have been more measured. So his response was to include in the drilling database a number of very poor quality holes that he'd previously taken out of the database because their quality was poor. And he used exactly the same criteria of samples within the search ellipse. That increased the measured resources to 75%. And he was then comfortable with that classification. But when I was auditing this, I had to say to him, I'm uncomfortable with the inclusion of these very poor quality holes, which you previously deemed unreliable. His response was, well, I had to do that because I had to get the measured resources up to what I felt was reasonable. My response to that was, in that case, you should have changed the number of samples that you'd selected within a search ellipse, because it was purely arbitrary. There was nothing magical about that number, and clearly it had not given him a result that he felt was appropriate. So don't get stuck on statistical parameters. Always make sure that what you're doing accords with your knowledge and feeling for the deposit and with the geology. A hypothetical example here is a qualified person one might classify a resource 50% inferred, 50% indicated, and that might lead to a mine life of 10 years, a net present value of 25 million. But another qualified person, equally qualified, equally experienced, might make the decision that 80% of the deposit should be inferred. That would reduce the mine life in this example to 4 years, net present value to 5 million. Maybe there's no project. And yet the only difference is the opinion of the qualified person, and they're both experienced people. The lesson from this is that if you're somebody who's using this mineral resource estimate, whether you're a mine manager, a CEO, a mining engineer, don't just blindly accept the classification that's been assigned, particularly when it comes to the inferred indicated boundary. Always go back and question the qualified or the competent person and make them justify what they've done. They ought to have good reasons for doing what they've done, because it can have a very fundamental effect on your project. That's the paper I've referred to a couple of times, and I won't go through it in detail other than to say that it was a group of us from AMC who prepared this paper back in 2006, and that is a group of mining engineers and geologists, and just getting mining engineers and geologists to co-write a paper was quite an achievement in itself. But it's become referred to quite a bit in the industry now, and an updated copy is available to you in your uploads. That's really just showing the inappropriate classification on the left and the appropriate on the right. That's in the paper. This is also in the paper. This is a very unusual one in that the measured category has been assigned between the drill holes. It's the only example I've ever seen of this. And it's an artifact of the search parameters. It's clearly illogical, but that was an example that AMC came across. Another case study that we were involved in, the resource was classified 70% measured, 30% indicated. When we, in this case, came to estimating and then classifying the reserve, we were uncomfortable with classifying any of it as proved, despite the fact that 70% was measured. The reason was that this is a block cave operation. There's a lot of material movement within block caves. That creates uncertainty as to exactly what's coming out when. And the measured indicated resources mixed together. They can't be mined separately. And so this approach was taken. Arguably, it was a conservative approach. Perhaps some of the earlier stage production could have been classified proved. But it does illustrate that the mining method can also impact, as I previously said, on the conversion. I won't go through this in detail. I've referred you to a paper by largely Harry Parker, who now with AMEC Foster Wheeler, and there's probably an updated reference to this paper from 2005. But it's a semi-quantitative approach, and I think it has a lot of merit. There are other issues that impact on classification. What scale are you classifying it at? And that's something that Harry Parker's approach deals with. You're not classifying on the basis of a single block, or you shouldn't be. You're not classifying on the basis of the entire deposit as one category. Obviously, you're doing something in between, but that volume is rarely given any thought. And the other aspect is cutoff grade. Most deposits, particularly those that have an erratic metal distribution, such as gold deposits, silver deposits, some silver deposits, diamonds, some tin deposits, the classification will vary with the cutoff grade. That's because the continuity decreases as you increase the cutoff grade. So a cutoff grade that was appropriate at a classification that was appropriate at a low cutoff grade won't necessarily apply at a higher cutoff grade. The importance of good reporting is internal reporting. It's vital that resource and reserve estimates are properly documented internally. That's because they are, as I said previously, the fundamental asset that underlies any mining operation. And also, external auditors, including from lending organizations, but really any person or group that is going to rely heavily on the resources and reserves will depend on good internal documentation. There is also, depending on the country you're in and the reporting jurisdiction, there may be a requirement to make public a report that details the resource and reserve estimate. It's not a requirement of every country, but more and more there is a requirement that either a report is provided or detailed accounting is provided in the public report answering the questions on the criteria that impacts most importantly on resource and reserve estimation. And the importance of good public reporting is pretty much, as I've said it before, it's a requirement now of most stock exchanges and commissions, and so it can be actually a legal requirement in some jurisdictions. Investors, if they have access to good reporting of the resources and reserves, are likely to have more confidence in investing in that company, and that's where most companies get their money. And it improves a company's ability to raise both debt and equity financing, and a company's ability to operate in non-domestic markets, because through CRSCO, which I'll come to in a moment, there is now a commonality of reporting standards in most of the important mining jurisdictions in the world. And coming on to that topic now, CRSCO, which I've referred to a few times, is the Committee for Mineral Reserves International Reporting Standards. It was formed in 1994. It represents an umbrella organisation with representatives from each of the resource reserve estimating, estimation reporting committees in each country. So there are two representatives from Australia, Canada, Mongolia, Russia, South Africa, UK / Ireland / Western Europe, USA and Chile. These are all countries that have or have adopted a reporting standard that is similar to the JORC code, to the CIM definition standards, to the SAMREC code and so on, and encapsulated in what's now called the CROSCO template. As an illustration of the importance of these reporting standards to fundraising in the mining industry, mining companies on these stock exchanges, where companies, the stock exchange has accepted a reporting standard based on CROSCO, account for more than 80%, probably a lot more now, of the listed capital of the mining industry. And CROSCO is a strategic partner of the ICMM, and it's very grateful for that support. It went through a period in its history when it may have failed altogether, but ICMM very kindly agreed to work with CROSCO and support the organisation, and it's now a very vibrant organisation. The characteristics of CROSCO-style reporting standards are that they are principles-based standards. And there's three fundamental underlying standards, I guess you'd say: transparency, materiality, and competence. These are also, although they might not be stated that way, these are also the principles that underlie most stock exchange listing rules and disclosure requirements. They represent a minimum standard for public reporting. You're always encouraged to report more than the minimum, and it's in your interest to do so publicly because the better informed investor is more likely to look on your company favorably. And as you've seen from the diagram, they set up a classification system according to geological confidence and technical economical considerations, as you've seen in the diagram that I showed before. They require public reports to be based on report undertaken by a qualified or a competent person, and that description of that I'll come to in a moment, but the main thing is that these persons can be held to account through a professional association. So these are the current reporting standards or codes that fit into the CROSCO style. The most recent one, only a year ago, is Mongolian code. The Russian code, name code, is a CROSCO style, although there's obviously still the traditional Russian system still applies there. And CROSCO is meeting next month with Brazil, and I believe that there is an expectation or a hope that Brazil will become the next country. This is the template that I referred to earlier. It's available on the CROSCO website, and it's the CROSCO website, which is well worth visiting. There is a lot of good information there and very useful links to other reporting organizations. It reflects the best of the most recently published reporting standards, and it acts as a model for any country that's looking to establish this sort of standard, and it has done for countries like Mongolia, Peru, the Philippines, Brazil, and so on. It also serves as a benchmark for comparison with other reporting systems, which I'll come to in a moment. The main reason, you might wonder why CROSCO-style reporting standards have become so dominant throughout the world. The reason is that they are oriented towards the public, and because of that, they are kept simple. It's very important when you are reporting to the public to keep what you're saying as simple as possible, while ensuring that you give all the information that's necessary for them to understand, not be misled. They have regulatory backing. In other words, the stock exchanges recognize and support them. There's an avoidance of too much prescription, although there is an amount that has to be done. They incorporate the qualified competent person system, which is essential to underpin these systems. And as I said, they're industry friendly, but they're designed with the investor in mind. The other systems that are out there, main ones, are the UNECE framework classification, and I'll come to more detail in that, and the Securities and Exchange Commission Industry Guide 7 in the USA. Just a couple of points on those two systems. This is a diagram that illustrates the UNECE framework classification system. As you can see, it's three-dimensional. There's a socio-economic axis, a feasibility axis, and a geological knowledge axis. In the CRISCO-style standards, these two axes, the socio-economic, or the E, and the feasibility, or the F, have been combined into the horizontal axis. And then there's G, the geological axis, is the same. When you compare UNFC with CRISCO-style, it actually creates over 40 possible categories of tonnage grade estimates. Now, the reality is that nowhere near 40 are used, but the setup of the three-dimensional matrix means that it is theoretically possible to have 40 categories. It is, though, used mainly for government reporting of entities and a country's entire amount of resource in the country, not just what's currently economically or potentially economically extractable. Doesn't have a competent or a qualified person concept, and very importantly, it's not commonly used by most banks and financing organizations in the mining industry today. That's a more detailed comparison, which I won't go into in detail. It's taken from a presentation by Roger Dixon, South African representative on CRISCO, presentation to the expert group of the UNECE in April this year. The Security and Exchange Commission differs very substantially from the CRISCO style. It doesn't allow the reporting of mineral resources unless they are required to be reported by law in another country. Now, they are required to be reported by law in Canada under 43101, and therefore companies that are dual listed in Canada and the USA can report mineral resources, but companies that are dual listed in Australia and the USA can't make use of that same provision because the JORC code, which is part of stock exchange listing rules in Australia, is not part of law. Where possible, the SEC requires the use of commodity prices based on the average of the last 3 years or on contract prices. Depending on the nature of the market cycle, of course, that may be misleading. So there is a requirement to provide a reconciliation to, I think it's spot prices, in situations where not to do so might mislead the public. And it's got a higher threshold for reporting mineral reserves for newer projects. It requires at least a feasibility study to have been undertaken. It doesn't have a competent or a qualified person concept. The qualified and the competent person concept. I've mentioned this several times. I will flick through some of these slides very quickly because I've said them before, but it's very important to recognize that this concept underpins the CRUSCO style report standards. It's not just the document, whether it's the JORC code or the CIM or SAMREC code. The document by itself does not constitute a CRUSCO style of reporting jurisdiction. There has to be a support mechanism in place that enables competent persons, qualified persons who don't, if you like, live by the rules to be disciplined. The qualified competent person is named in the public report. It has to be prepared under their supervision or by them. There can be an employee or a consultant. Although where independence is required, they would have to be a consultant. They must be a member of a professional society that requires compliance with professional ethics and has disciplinary powers. They must have at least 5 years of relevant experience. Relevant experience, that's often asked, what do you mean by relevant experience? There is guidance in each of the reporting standards, so my advice is to read those standards, and if you're still in doubt, talk to some of your peers to determine whether you believe you have the right experience. And this is what I'm saying here. Ask yourself, if you're a qualified person, do you belong to an appropriate professional organization? It must be one of the ones that's been recognized. Do you have the required minimum relevant experience? So, as I said, go to the standards and read up on relevant. If you have doubt, you should seek an opinion from a colleague, or you should decline to act as a qualified or a competent person. There is now considerable inter-country recognition of professional organizations so that somebody who is a member, for example, of the APEC BC in Canada can report in Australia under the JORC code as long as they do have the required professional experience. I'll spend a few slides on this because it is important, this judgment call, and this is part of the reason why we decided to offer this webinar, because we'd seen this being either misunderstood or not sufficiently regarded. The definition in the CRUSCO template of a resource is a concentration or occurrence of solid material of economic interest in or on the Earth's crust, in such form, grade, or quality and quantity, and then this is the important phrase, that there are reasonable prospects for eventual economic extraction. Now, there's guidance in the CRUSCO template and in each of the reporting standards, and this guidance is pretty much the same in each of the reporting standards. And what it's saying is it does require, in this case, used the word competent, but it's the same as qualified person. It does require that person to exercise a judgment in respect of the technical and economic factors likely to influence the economic extraction. So what it means is a mineral resource isn't just everything that's been drilled, regardless of the cutoff grade or regardless of how it might be mined or where it is or the continuity of the mineralization. And this was an evolution from 20 to 30 years ago when, before the JORC code came in 1989, there wasn't this constraint on how you reported a mineral resource. There wasn't the requirement that it had to have reasonable prospects of eventual economic extraction. And so the public reading estimates didn't know whether it was reasonable there was a good chance that it could be eventually mineable, or it included material that had been drilled, but there was no chance that it could ever be mined. That changed in 1989 when the JORC Code came in. And so you can summarize it as a realistic inventory of mineralization which, under assumed and justifiable technical and economic conditions, might, in whole or in part, become economically extractable. So it does require the competent or the qualified person to exercise judgment. This is why it's important that these people have experience before being asked to or accepting acting as a qualified or a competent person. You must state any material assumptions, in other words, any important assumptions. Interpretation of the word eventual. This is not easy because it is very project and situation dependent. For bulk mining or for project deposits such as some iron ore deposits or bauxite, or ones that have an extremely long life, eventual might mean 50 years. But for more, if you like, typical base and precious metal deposits, probably eventual is more in the order of 5 to 10 to 15 years. But don't get hung up on those numbers. It's up to the qualified or the competent person to make that judgment call. And as long as you have a sound basis for making that judgment and you can explain it to somebody, you should feel comfortable making it. I won't go through this in detail, but there's updated guidance in the CIM definition standards on what the qualified person should consider when they're looking at eventual economic extraction. But I believe this one's important in the definition standards because it's become almost standard practice, or it's now assumed that it's a requirement for a mineral resource in an open pit situation to be constrained within a pit shell, or in an underground situation to be constrained within a preliminary underground mining outline. Now, that is a good way of making that decision as to reasonable prospects of economic extraction. But it's not the only way, and it is not a requirement of any of the reporting standards, nor of 43101, I believe, of law in other countries, although I'm not familiar with law in all countries in this respect. So you'd need to make that judgment call. How you do it is the qualified or a competent person's decision. Using a pit shell is a very logical way to go for an open pit, and using a preliminary mining outline is a logical way to go for underground, but they're not essential. I'm not going to go through this section because we don't have time, and it's more specific to those involved in 43101 reports. Not everybody on this webinar is involved in those sorts of reports. However, you will get a copy of this presentation, and you will be able to read the slides then. I will, though, mention a case study that occurred in 2012 in Canada. A company called Extore Gold Mines had to terminate a $50 million share offer. The reason it had to terminate it was that the British Columbia Securities Commission was not comfortable about the manner in which the company had referred to a PEA, preliminary economic assessment, on a project. Because in the BCSC's opinion, the disclosure, both in the technical report but also preceding it on the website, had characterized a lot of what was being done as a PFS. And it appeared to the BCSC that it had then been reported as a PEA in order to allow the inclusion of inferred resources. That was the BCSC's commentary on the matter. But you can see that the regulators in Canada do take very seriously everything that a company says about a study that it's preparing and how it relates particularly to PEAs and feasibility and pre-feasibility studies. I'll finish, and I believe there's about 1 or 2 minutes to go, with a reference to Busang. And this has to be probably the classic case study of, well, certainly recent time. I had a little bit of involvement in this as an expert, but only fleetingly. But for those who aren't aware of it, I will read through this because I think it's useful. Throughout 1996-97, a Toronto-listed company called Briex, it was actually based in Alberta, I believe, announced progressively greater resource estimates for a project called Busang, which is in Indonesia, and in fact not very far from the Kalian deposit, which I referred to earlier on in this presentation. And their estimates culminated in 71 million ounces in February 1997, although there were references, I understand, to perhaps as much as 200 million ounces. The company was pressured, or let me rephrase that. The company was encouraged to engage with a major company to develop the project. So Freeport agreed to acquire 15% subject to due diligence. And when it started conducting its due diligence, which included drilling, it found little or no gold in its drill holes. As this began to trickle out, rumors started to fly around the industry. One of the occurrences was that the chief geologist of Briex, Michael de Guzman, allegedly committed suicide. Nobody's quite sure. He fell out of a helicopter, or at least that's what was alleged to have occurred. Nobody's quite sure whether it occurred or whether, in fact, he's still alive somewhere. In May 1997, an independent consultant concluded on the basis of further check drilling that Busang, in fact, was a massive fraud, that somebody had been salting the core, in other words, adding gold to the core, and artificially increasing the grade of the project. Lawsuits began. The chairman of Briex passed away not too many years later. Most of the people involved had disappeared into other countries. And the last lawsuit that was brought was dismissed in 2007 when John Felderhoff was found not guilty of insider trading. That was Briex's share price. As you can see, it went from very little, almost zero, up to over $26 and plunged back down again to, well, zero once the fraud was outlined. This is a cross-section through one of Briex's drill holes. And these histograms are the gold assays. As you can see, absolutely spectacular gold values. This is a check drill hole by the consulting company Strathcona. As you can see, almost nothing. So I think we can probably put Busang into the pie in the sky with some degree of confidence, and we sincerely hope that we will never see anything like Busang again. So ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to thank you for taking part in this webinar. As a reminder, you can, if you haven't submitted questions, you can still submit questions. Sorry, I was just checking that you could do that. I can be reached directly on my email address at pstevenson@amcconsultants.com. I believe that will be available to you anyway, if it's not already. Once you leave today's webinar, you'll receive a very short survey. It really won't take much of your time, but it would be very useful for us and to decide or to understand how this went across, what we could have done better, what you would have liked to see more of, what you think perhaps could have been omitted. So you would appreciate if you could complete those. The webinar is recorded for archives, and if you're interested in a copy of this webinar, please let me know. We're working on how to make copies available to you. At this stage, we haven't exactly determined that, but we're working on that, and if we can do it, we will. So, on behalf of AMC Consultants and the organizers of this webinar, thank you again very much, and have a good day.